Check, 1, 2. Check. Check. Check, 1. Check, 1, 2. Hey, y'all just have to deal with me. But this is how I roll. Check, 1, 2.
Oh! Going to glory! Thank you. Thank you. Stop it. and I won't turn back. You can't stop me, and I won't turn back. You can't stop me, and I won't turn back. 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 Until I see this rain, I won't turn back. From feelings and rain, I won't turn back. We reach his hand, I won't turn back. I get to the land, I won't turn back. I won't turn back. Oh, you can't stop me, then I won't turn back. You can't stop me, then I won't turn back. You can't stop me, then I won't turn back. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It ain't over. It's your God, sir. Start it over. And one thing about the text of God, God never says that it's over. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. But I know when we all get together, what a day of rejoicing there's going to be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout. Victory. How many believe that? How many believe that? How many know that God is still God? And he's the one that sitteth high and look home. Behold! Oh! 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 Oh, Jesus! Hallelujah, Jesus! Hallelujah, Jesus! Hallelujah. He's a gracious God. Hallelujah. He's that magnificent God. He's that omnipotent one. Huh? God is an awesome God. Oh my God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh my. Thank you, Jesus. Oh Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh, my soul. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I know Mother Annie Bell. Huh? And one thing about it, every time she came into the door, she looked for something going on. Amen. When she come into a church, she expect church be having church. When I first met her, she said, "Now don't come in here and put me to sleep. I hope you want to know why I'm a kind of preacher." And when she got to know me, she said, "You my dancing preacher." But today, now I know that's on the program, it says a home going, right? Now, let me break a few things down to you before we get started real good. Now, you know how it is when your son or your children come home from college, huh? They stay a little while, and then you get ready to send them off. And you send them off for a little while, but they never leave your mind. You're always wondering how they're doing, whether they're eating right, who they're connected with over there. But let me tell you something. That's a send-off. Huh? But ain't nothing like homecoming. Anybody remember homecoming? Now, we experience a homegoing over here. But over there, her sister, loved ones, friends, and families that, whoo, they have gone on before, they're so excited because she's finally coming home. Now, we're not going to sit here and say that you ain't going to miss them, huh? But we just want to remind you, we missed them over here for a little while. But they've been missing her over there for a long time. Huh? And now it's homecoming. You know how it is when you welcome somebody home and you have all the balloons and all the banners hanging? And ain't nothing like waiting for your loved one to come home with open arms. Oh, we got a heavy heart over here. But my God, the rejoicing that's going on over there, huh? My Bible tells me to be absent from this body, to be present with the Almighty God. This God that we've been singing about and praying to Him, huh? And acknowledging in our prayers and hoping for and have faith to believe that exists. It's a bittersweet moment. It's bitter because we got to lose over here. But my God, sweet glory land. So I'm not here to burden you down, but I'm here to bring some excitement because Mother Annabelle was excited. And she didn't do a whole lot of hand waving and hollering and screaming, but she sat over there and smiled sometimes and just nodded her head. Sometimes she get happy and I see the little twitch of her head turn to the side like this, and she got it in. And she would always tell you, you got to be real and you got to be right. That's where I get my saying from, Pastor Roy. When I came into the door, she said, "You got to be real, and you got to be right." I don't know where you came from, but that's on the inside that I love it. Huh? And that was their joy. So let us not reflect on the sorrows, but let respect on the great things. Let respect those things that she have left behind. Amen? No, I'm not there to preach the funeral. I'm here to moderate. But I want you all to know, just get ready. Because if you're looking for a sad day, it ain't going to happen up in here. Amen? Lift up your heavy hearts. The Lord will help you. And let's come before Him with praise, thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen? Now, this time, we're not going to hold you long, but we're going to have a processional. All right, then, I'm just going by the program. I'm excited. So without further ado, we're going to call for our very own Bishop Orville Peterson Senior to lead us in a word of prayer.
What a day. Come on, give the Lord some praise. He's worthy. He's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. Just before I pray, I just want to say that what you're looking at is a spiritual legacy. Amen. We are here to celebrate the homegoing of a third generation, last of the third generation of this family. Matriarchs, parents were patriarchs and matriarchs. And these people were leaders in their profession of faith. Nothing has broken their faith. Nothing has shackled their movement, but they have been consistent. They sought that they have found the right door and the right gate. And they did what Jesus said, to strive to enter in, fight to get in there. For straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth to life. And very few there be, the scripture says, that find it. Let us bow our heads in a moment of prayer. God of our Father, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. You've been our shelter in the storms of our lives. You have guided us over the thresholds of disaster and chaos. You brought us this far because you have come this far by faith, leaning on the everlasting arm. Father, we thank you again, once again, to come in your presence and to acknowledge that you are God. You said in your word to us in the midst of adversity, for us to be still and know that I am God. To recognize your presence in every movement of this universe, that God, you are always in control. Hallelujah. We yield ourselves to you, God, because of ourselves, we just can't do anything. We find our life worthless, not even worth living without you. You've been the strength of our lives. You've been the God of all ages. God, now you are manifesting in this last time generation. And Father, we are praying today as the third of our matriarchs have left us, that somebody in this fourth generation will pick up the mantle that has fallen and move forward in faith. We pray that I would grant the intermediate family, the McLendon, those sons and daughters and grandchildren and great-grand, that somehow, somewhere, somebody will bring forth and burst forth and grab a hold of the mantle that has fallen and to move forward into another generation and pass on what those who have preceded us has passed on to us. Give us grace to go forward, Lord. Help us to stand firm. Help us to build our faith on a rock that is unmovable, unshakable. We've had that anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while these terrible kinds of billows breaking over our faith and our heads. God, we ask you to grab us by our hands and never let go until we reach the promised land that you have engaged us to from this generation. Father, we ask that thou will touch us today. Magnify thyself. Let thy name be exalted. Let thy name be praised. Oh God, and so much that those who don't know you will get a hold of the altar. The fire that is now falling from the altar would fall on us and saturate our lives, that we'll become, oh God, that monument, that movement of God that will start this world and change things as they are. Give us grace. Help us to be humble in faith. Help us not to be exalted in self, but let ourselves be crucified. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Touch us right now. Send forth thy spirit. Saturate this place with your glory. Let your glory shine, Lord. Help us to get a hold of these people, so that when we found this end, when we reach the end of our journey, hallelujah. We thank you for peace. For when peace like a river attended my way, and when sorrows like sea billows flow, whatever my lot, whatever comes, thou hast brought me to stay. It is well. Hallelujah. It is well. It is well.
This time we're going to have our scripture readings from the Old Testament, Pastor Nathan Peterson, from the New Testament, Elder Ricardo Hester, as we get ready to receive at this time our scriptures. Pastor Peterson.
From the Old Testament, Psalms 90, verses 1 through 17. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction, and saith, return ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep. In the morning they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years and 10. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long? And let it repent thee concerning thy servant. O satisfy us early with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad according to the days wherein thou hast afflicted us, and the years wherein we have seen evil. Let thy works appear unto thy servants, and thy glory unto their children. 17 in all. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish thou the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the works of our hand establish thou it. The word of the Lord is already blessed.
Praise the Lord, church. Praise the Lord, family. All right. Let's wake up out there. I had asked Flossie, is this going to be a memorial or is this a homegoing celebration? She said, Rick, we're going to have church. Amen. A very familiar passage of scripture, St. John 14. You know, Mother Annie Bell have been sending up her timber for a long time. Amen. So I asked the Lord, well, what scripture should I read? And this is what he gave. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, but also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Lord, have mercy. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whether I go, ye know, and the way, you know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto me but by the Father. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, ye know him and have seen him. Amen. Let's go and have church, y'all.
Did you hear those scriptures? If you had known him. Woo. That's powerful, isn't it? He's not asking you just to believe. Because there's many people that say they believe and go back and do the same thing. But when you know your God, and he said, my people shall know their God, and they shall be strong and do exploits. Amen? That's an awesome God. He ain't looking for you to do exploits when you get to heaven. That's where a lot of us mess up at. But he wants us to do those great things right here. Huh? And I'm a witness that mother was doing those great things right here. Huh? One thing about it, you got to be real or you got to be right. Huh? And if any time you was in her presence and you wasn't doing right, she'll give you that nod. Like I said, she wasn't going to say much. She'll give you that nod. And if you don't get it right, she'll give you that little nod that way and say, come here. Then she'll whisper to you. That's what I love about her. She ain't going to embarrass you before everybody. But she'll call you to whisper in your ear and saying, all right now, you got to straighten up and you got to fly right. For a long time, I didn't know what that means, Pastor. When I was young, coming up, you got to straighten up and you got to fly right. Until one day I seen old bird got hit. And that bird went to flying all kind of sideways and hitting obstacles. But when he straightened up and got his balance, my God, did he fly. So my God, let me tell you something. You're going to hit some stumbling blocks. You're going to hit some obstacles on this journey. You're going to hit some inclines and some downs, barely low. But guess what? If you know your God, woo! My God, he'll raise you up every time. And when you think you're gonna lay down for the last time, woo! That's when he's gonna raise you up forever. You understand? Anybody know what forever means? God is an awesome God. Now we ain't gonna murder you down today. Like I said, mother was all about church. She was all about living right. It wasn't so much about the building, but it was about your heart. Huh? Many of us can go to the building. And right now, COVID got a lot of people shut down from the building. But let me tell you something, you still get God in your heart. He said, love the Lord thy God with all your heart. Now, you ain't gonna do that, my God, everything else is gonna be added. Now, we getting ready from rejoicing from the family. We getting ready for the family choir to come up and give us some praises unto our God. At this time, amen, family. All right then. We already got somebody in the hostess ready to fire up. Let's go, family choir. Amen. Let's have some church in this house. Come on, family choir. Thank you.
Church. Praise the Lord. Listen, this is just a brief announcement for station identification. I know many of you have been interested in receiving a program. We have been following directions by the family. The remaining programs that we have will be passed out to the choir because they are family. If you are still interested post this day of receiving an obituary, Sister K. Ilette, she has said to you to refer all inquiries to her. So if you don't know who Kay is, that's the short one from the front. That's Kay. Okay? We still in Jesus? Do you still love me? Are you angry because you didn't get your program? Talk to God about it.
Y'all don't want to have no church. Come on now. I don't know about you, but we need his power. Huh? We need that Holy Ghost power. That quick, won't stop power. That everlasting, rejuvenating power. That power that destroys every yoke. through the anointing of God. My God, my God. How many know he's real? Now this time we're going to have some special expressions. We're not going to hold you long, but these are the people that was near and dear to Mother's heart. And we're going to call forth these expressions at this time so they can have words. As a church mother, we're going to call at this time Tanya Robinson McDonald. And she's coming forth to give some expressions of how she knows her as a church mother.
Praise God. Amen. This is a bittersweet day for me. Mother was a mother to me. I'm Kate's adopted sister. And mother was a good mother. She was a mother of the church. She was a humorous person. She was not, she wasn't a dry Christian. I put it like that. She wasn't a dry Christian. Mother always had something funny to say. She made the best out of the worst situations. Mother was just mother. Yeah, and when she didn't see you in church, she would do a drive-by. Mother do a drive-by on you. She'd have pastor to put her in the car, she'd come by, and she never called me by Sister Tanya. She would say, Sister Sonia. She would always, Sister Sonia, you've been missing out of church. Where you been? We missing you. You need to be in church. And I say, yes, ma'am, mother. I know. I say, I stayed out a little late. She said, well, you come on to church. God will do the rest. You just come on. And, you know, I'm going to miss mother. Her favorite word was showing up. When pastor people get to preaching, she getting into the Holy Ghost over there. She's all like, showing up, pastor, showing up, preach. And, you know, I'm really going to miss her. I'm going to miss her. I'm going to look over in the corner, and she's not going to be there, but I know she's there in spirit, and I know she's watching down over all of us right now. And mother was a church. She was not a worrier. She prayed about things. You could go to mother. Like you say, she would pull you to the side and whisper in your ear. She wouldn't make no embarrassment about nothing. She'd say, well, you know, just tell God about it. Tell God about it. I was going through a situation with my son at one time, and mother said, you know what, Sister Sonia, you get them children to God. Give them to God. He'll save them. She said, he saved every last one of mine. They're all seven of them saved. And she said, my grandchildren, they're going to be saved too. I might not be here to see it, but all of them going to be saved. And she even spoke down to her next generation of grands. And, you know, and I just want to say, family, y'all my family too. Be encouraged. Know that mother lived a good life. She lived a long, good, prosperous life. Mother loved children. She knew how to conversate from the smallest to the oldest in the church. She always brought joy. She always welcomed everybody to the church. When you met mother, you didn't meet no stranger, and you left being loved and filled with love, because she always gave you something positive out of a negative situation. She always gave you the good out of the bad. And I'm definitely going to miss her, and I know you guys are going to miss her as well, but we know that she's in heaven right now. I know without a shadow of a doubt, mother's in heaven praising God, because she loved God. She loved church. Even when she was sick, when Kay wouldn't bring her, she'll be saying, Lord, I want to be in church so bad, but they just told me, Mama, stay home. She said, I just want to be there because I know my healing is in the church. My healing is in the church. And she said, you know, y'all young people, y'all go to church. Honor y'all parents. Respect your parents. You'll live good. You'll live a good life. Everything will go well with you. And, you know, and I believe that. And I believed it from the time I heard it from a little child up to now. If you honor your parents, everything will go well with you. And mother believed that, and she drilled that into the little kids in the church. And she would always stand up and testify and tell those kids, honor your parents, obey them. Everything will go well with you. You want to be a doctor, you want to be a lawyer, God gonna reverence that if you obey your parents. It starts with the parents. So you obey your parents. Whether they doing right or wrong, you obey them. And mother taught that, and you know, that's good. That's what you find in a good mother, because they're gonna tell you the right from the wrong. And mother did just that. And I'm definitely and sure enough gonna miss her. I'm gonna miss her in the corner over there. And saying, sure enough.
Get in our church and let's go home. Get in our church and let's go home. Get in our church. Get in our church. Get in our church and let's go home. I said, get in our church and let's go home. God's a good God. Isn't he good? How many want to get it right? God's an awesome God. I don't know about you, but I'm going to be ready when he comes. Amen. God is good. Now we're going to move on down. As a special cousin and friend, Mother Willie Bell here, we're going to call Mother Willie Bell. Amen. Bless the Lord. Go ahead, Mother Willie Bell. Yes, Lord, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. No problem. There you go.
My husband and I got married. Hallelujah. And that means that I knew her a long time. Amen. And when I did get married, she said, now you in the family now. You got to stay. I said, what do you mean by that? She said, you got to stay in the family. You can't go nowhere. And I said, all right, Belle, now you don't know. I might be moving on. She said, yeah, you moving on, coming to get you. We had times that we cried together. Amen. And that through it all, we had the same amount of children. And I watched our children grow up. Amen. Because they were little bitty lads and little girls when I met Bell. Amen. And Ray, when he finished school, he went away. And when he came back. And he always would come by my house. He always would have something to say. Willie Bell, you got all them children. You know, you got a lot of children. He said, you're going to have to need a bus after a while. I said, all right, Ray. And so when I would get with Bell, I would tell Bell, she said, you know what? She said, I know that old Bay Ray. She said, that Bay Ray used to just bother the children, aggravate them. She said, Bay Ray loved you, that's why he aggravated you. I said, you know what? That's all right. But she said, you know what? Willie Bell, Bay Ray don't know. It's seven to them. She said, I had seven too. She said, he talking about you? I had seven of them too. And so I said, Bell, you know what? That's right. And she said, Ray, he always had a nitpicking word. And I always had to get on Ray. I was over the Easter and the Christmas program at Northside. And at that time I couldn't drive. I wasn't driving. So I go by there and Bell would take them. We would walk to Northside to have practice for Christmas and Easter. And that made Ray. You always had to say something to him. If he didn't keep up with everybody else, he would lag behind him. I said, get on up here. And now when we get to the church, he always nitpicking the church. Do you know your speech? I know mine. And I would get back to the house, she said, Willie Bell, how did they act? I said, everybody was good, but that bitch. She said, I know. You say nothing. I could just say, I love Belle. We were always, and when I was in the hospital, she came to see me twice, before. And she said, well, man, you got to get up from here. She said, you can't lay down out here. She said, you know, you got to get up. She said, you raised your children. You always mother up nice and beautiful lady. And she said, I know that woman be in the corner so well, but one eye open and looking at you. And she said, but you got to get up from here. And you know, I thank God for her today. Her dad wasn't up. She wasn't up. Like I said, she was no bored, kept perfect. She always made me laugh. She always said something to encourage me. Man, and I thank God for that. You know, she helped me. She encouraged me when I was coming along with my children. I can go to bed and I talk to her. You know, it's a lot of my cousins that I could do that with. And they're going on. But you know, Belle was left here a long time. And then she would say, you know, I would call you on the phone. Well, she called me a couple of times. She said, I would come over there and see if I could drive. She said, I can't drive. And I can't come to see, but she would call me. And you know, when I heard about Belle, Belle just didn't play her. And they saw the song. They flew away with the Lord to keep the Lord. You know, all this stuff has to go along with that. She don't have to worry about that no more. None of this stuff now that she got to worry about. She's with the Lord today. And you know what? We got to make our recording in the next show. And we got to have love in our heart. For one another. Just don't talk it. We got to live it. We are the family. And stop pushing away this side of the family. Push it that way. You got to bring one another together in love. Like Belle did. She loved all of us. She has something good to say to all of us. And that's what we got to do. I love you, sister. Belle, I'm
hallelujah. For God loves the best. Let's go down by the river. 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 There'll be joy by the river. There'll be joy by the river. Let's go down 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 by the river. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on now. Woo! Yes, Lord. We're going to keep on rolling. As a God daughter. Oh, my God. As a God daughter. We're going to call Michelle Anders. Amen. As a God daughter. How many know it's good to have God parents? Some people make it say that they're God parents, but it's good to have a godly God parent. Amen. At this time, as a God daughter.
Hello, everyone. Giving honor to God. I came all the way from New Jersey to see my aunt. It's a long story. I got a long story, but it's not enough time. But she's She held me as a little baby, I heard. Well, she told me millions of times. I was born in Harrisburg, and I was raised here in Gifford. And her and my grandmother was like the best of friends. They were cousins. Then later in life, she married my uncle, Harry Collier, which is, she played to me on both sides. And all I can remember is right now I'm a little emotional because about 2 years ago, I came for a funeral, and they said she was in the church. And I felt so guilty because I come down here, I get with the family, and run around, people pulling me from left to right, and I wanted to see her every time, not just all over the place. Like, I'm here now, I'm all over the place. And I walked into the church, and I asked the entrance, can I see her? She's like, no. She's in front of the church. And I was like, well, I guess I'll wait. So they had her walking outside the church. I mean, she's leaving. And they said, Mama can't see that good. And she looked at me, and she seen me, and she's like, is that my baby? And she almost fainted. Connie was standing with me, and they had to literally catch her because she just couldn't believe it was me. And she said something to me. She's like, you wouldn't have to be 90 years old to see me. And I said, I couldn't say nothing. All I could do was just hug her. And she was like, I gotta see you again. So I took a trip. I went back to my hotel, and I told Connie, I said, I can't even enjoy myself now. I said, because she made me cry. She made me cry literally a whole day because I stood in that hotel, and I was like, this lady really loved me, and she really did love me. I remember being 14 years old, and she was trying to get me to live with her, and I was like, no, I'm going to go to church every day. And she will always tell me she wanted me to do something with myself. Don't, you know. And then my mother, a lot of people think that my mother, for whatever reason, is from here, but she's not. She's from Harrisburg. And I found my mother because I was actually taken away from my mother, me and my siblings. And I turned around later in life about, I think I was 20 years old when I found my mother. And all my mom could talk about is her. And I didn't even know my mother knew her like that. So when I visit my mother would talk about her constantly. She would talk about all the sisters, brothers. And she always told me how well Aunt Bell treated her. But yesterday, to be here to see her, my mother died a year ago yesterday from COVID. And it's just sad all the way around for me because I don't know how I feel losing her and seeing her body and then knowing my mom is gone a year ago. And this weekend I plan to go bury my mother's ashes with her mother. And I said, I'm sure my mother would have wanted me to be here. So I'm just here to tell y'all that my cousin Lilibel was right. She's a wonderful woman. I always knew that she loved me, and I can at least know that she really did love me. So I want to tell the family I love y'all, and the ones I don't know, can't believe half of the people I've seen, I don't know y'all. But I would like to get to know you. So God bless everybody.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. I'm not doubting by the way. I'm not doubting by the way. I'm not doubting. I knew much about you. I'm not doubting by the way. God is good. God is good.
wondering why I'm singing these little old songs, but that's what mother loves, see? She like when you come in and you hit them old songs, see? This new stuff is okay, but when you strike up those songs that take her back in the day, see? Huh? She said, you're a young man with an old soul, that's what she said. Amen. But them old tunes, I'm about it. And if you knew her, woo! Like the next individual gonna come up as I knew her. Erin Johnson, as you make your way down, as I knew her, Erin Johnson.
Mask off, I can't even breathe. First of all, to the family, my heart just is still broken, but you know. Woo! Oh man. Tell you what, the devil tried to get in the way, but God didn't let him. Planes kind of tried to get that to the airport down the BWI down in Baltimore. Like three accidents at traffic on 83 North and backed up. But God got me there and get into Orlando to about 11 o'clock last night. And guess what? As far as getting a rental car, they wanted $455 for one day. I was like, okay, now how am I gonna get around this obstacle? So what I did was, I said, hey, I gotta get an Uber. So I caught me an Uber down here, and the gentleman's out there waiting for me. Actually, it's actually my wife's birthday today, so she's up there. But like I told her, I said, listen here. I said, I know your birthday's Saturday, but it's a place I gotta be down in Gifford, Florida. So all I can tell you, you can stay home or you can come with me. Because this woman right here, as far as I'm concerned, she's great. This woman right here, it's almost 50 years since Miss Bell talking about when the McLendons moved to Harrisburg. I'm representing Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, y'all. South side of Harrisburg, where we grew up in the projects. Okay? The McLendons lived in the Hoover homes, and I lived in Hall Manor. Projects was right across the street, basically. But let me tell you, that Miss Annabelle's something else. Let me tell you, they had a gremlin. I'm 63, so you figure a gremlin, somebody my age know what a gremlin is. That little compact car. So you just heard everybody say it was seven of them. So you can imagine everybody trying to get in that gremlin. But let me tell you something. Miss Annabelle's gonna get you where she had to go. All right, so we all piled up in there like sardines. But anyway, Miss Annabelle was my mentor. You know, everybody just said she was the same person every time you seen her. Every time you seen her. Every time. Always had something kind to say. Always. She'd take something bad and turn it into good. You know, I had the great fortune, my daughter, Shemetta McLendon, what y'all call near, born July 16, 1974. 421 in Hershey, Pennsylvania. Now, let me tell you what Hershey, Pennsylvania is. Again, Ms. Annabelle's something else. Now, Hershey, Pennsylvania, I'm talking about, that's white rich money. Okay? That's where all the white rich people live in. Well, my daughter was born in Hershey, Pennsylvania at the Hershey Medical Center. So I'm saying, whoa, how'd she get down here? Her words to me always was, a quiet mouth don't get fed. Miss Annabelle's gonna make sure that her kids, her family's gonna be taken care of. And I'm telling you, Hershey Medical Center is the best of the best. And from that day on, I never kept my mouth shut because if it's out there, I'm gonna get it. And that's how Miss Annabelle was. But I'm gonna tell you something though. She was something else. She was something else. She was something else. And I don't know what your relationship was with her, but as I got older, stayed in touch, you know. And my relationship with her was, I always made sure she had what she needed. She called near and there said, hey, what grandmom said, I said, ain't no problem. But I know Nera told her, I got this big promotion. Now, you know Miss Annabelle loves money. You do know that, don't you? Okay, I'm going to go there with you. Okay. You know she loves money. So she called me. She said, she either called me, she never called me Aaron. She always say Aaron. So she said, Aaron, Nera tell me you got a big promotion up there. You making some good money up there. I said, what she told you? She said, yeah, you know, you got to send me some of that money down here now. So, you know, I'll tell you, I take care of her, though. But I'm telling you, she is something else, you hear me? She is something else. So this one time, right, I want to share this with you. Now, you know she loved the Lord. Know she loved the Lord. Everybody in here said that. Well, again, she the one that brought me to the Lord, because, you know, I didn't know anything about the Lord. Just like the young lady said, you know, I didn't want to live with her because I didn't want to go to church every day. I understand what she's saying. So this one particular day, we go up there, little small church, little corner church, Six and Riley up in Harrisburg. Me and my sister getting to church. When I tell you, Miss Annabelle was the entire choir. I mean, she went from the drums to the keyboard. and then you talking about a joyful sound. She screamed something out, you know what I mean? And then this gentleman in the back was waving his hand, right? So Miss Annabelle said, hey, y'all gotta excuse me for a minute, because Brother Jenkins, if we don't get him something to eat, he'll be diabetic. Miss Annabelle was something else. She was something else. She was something else. There's no way in the world I couldn't attend this. I'm telling you. I told my wife, I said, I got to get out of here, because I'm definitely gonna be in Guilford, Florida. And you know, the crazy thing about it is this here, and some of y'all might know Phil Humphreys. And Phil Humphreys was from Guilford. Me and Phil, and actually Ray, was stationed in Fort Hood, Texas together. I'm telling you, but it's just the weirdest thing. I'm in the barracks one day, I'm looking on Phil's wall, we were roommates. And I see, look on there, I see Nair and Flossie's picture up there. I'm like, how do you know them? I said, Phil, that's my daughter. Phil thought I was lying. I said, Phil, that's my daughter, man. I said, well, Ray's stationed down here. It's a small world. You know, they tell me, Phil, you know, passed away, but, I'm gonna tell you something. This family here always been good to me. I love you, you know. Your mom laid the foundation out for you. She laid it out for you, you know. All y'all know God. She raised y'all the right way. And guess what? Like I said, we came from the projects up in Harrisburg. All of us is doing very well, very well. What she witnessed was that struggle. Then she had an opportunity to live with each and every one of y'all. To get a taste of that success. She's been truly blessed. And she's a woman of God. She's been truly blessed. And I just thank God for having her in my life, because she's always been good to me. She's been good to me. She's been good to me. I thank God for Miss Annabelle. I thank God for this family. And again, we're going to be all right. Thank you.
Some folks would rather have houses on the land. Some folks want silver and gold. But these things they cherish and forget all about their soul. But I decide to make Jesus my choice. Right that time, right, Pastor? God is good. God is awesome.
At this time, amen, we're going to have some reflections. But please, ladies and gentlemen, govern yourself accordingly. Because at 3 minutes, I will be saying amen. Amen. So we give you a chance to express yourself for those 3 minutes. In 3 minutes, please, as the program said, you see on the program, said 3 minutes, please. Please, 3 minutes. Amen. I know you got much love for Mother Annabelle. Now, if you're going to come, come on up. Amen. And give your reflections. Amen. 3 minutes. Amen. And we know everybody in the church know and love her, but we're not calling for the whole church to come up. Amen. So y'all please respect the family wishes. And at this time, we're going to open up for 3 minutes of peace. And at 3 minutes, like I said, I will be saying amen. Amen. She told me to keep it tight but right. Amen. When we're in church, keep it tight but right. Don't drag the service. Amen. Keep it fired up and let's go with it. Amen. So we're going to have these reflections, and then after that, amen, Brother Broxton is going to be coming. Amen. Bring us some tunes, so I need y'all to hang tight with me on this brother's saxophone. Mother loved to hear him play that saxophone. Every time he walked in the door, when we was pastoring down here, me and Pastor Roy myself, and when James came in the door, she said, "Did you bring your saxophone?" Amen. At this time, 3 minutes, we're going to have reflection.
But then, Bill, she loved, I know the whole family, all the sisters, and all of them gone home to be with the Lord. And my mother's life, oh, my mama, I miss her right now. Praise God. I thank God for this family. I thank God for Miss Annie Bell. And like everybody sees, she loves the church. She'd have you laughing. She just make you feel so good when you see her. And I'm going to miss her. And like she said, when you walk in the door, you got to be real. That go over there. I ain't going to say it. But the song here, that'll be real. Everything. I'll sing it in the choir. That'll be real. Everything. Not something. But everything you do for Jesus, you got to be real. Ain't no end there about it. If you ain't real, you phony. If you ain't real, you false. If you ain't real, you fake. So, you know, you got to be real. Everything you do for Jesus, you got to. And you must be holy. That's the only way you're going to see Jesus, being holy. Have peace with all mankind. Without holiness, no man can see the Lord.
That's all right. Let it be real. Amen. Amen. Let it be real. That's all right, mother. That's all right. I feel you. Let her dance on. Let her dance on. Amen. If you can't praise him, don't you hit the mother. Amen. That's all right, mother. I feel you. Amen. Reflection. Okay.
Amen. I'm going to thank God today for the family. All of you. Bill and I grew up together. We are alone. We started years ago in their home. That's where the Church of God was birthed at. Right in their home. Bill taught me in Sunday school. So all we ever knew was Jesus. And how to get from earth to glory, that all was taught to us. I met my wife there in her home. We were together for 61 years, my wife and I. And let me put it this way, give a little analogy if you don't mind, please. We started out, Belle, Rose, and myself, on this highway, and there's supposed to be 3 exits there that you get off in Glory Land.
died off on God Street. Look like Bear died off on Jesus. There's only one left. I'm gonna get off here because I need help. I suggest you get on Woodrow Street too. They tell me at the end of this highway that there's a deep hole there. Has no bottom to it. And they're spying. And if you don't get off on Woodrow Street like with me, you're going to fall in and never stop falling. That's the way Bell would teach it. So I said to you, as you travel this journey, remember there's only three exits. God Street, Jesus Street, Holy Ghost Avenue. Thank you.
Good morning, good afternoon. I didn't come here to speak that morning. I just came to give my regards. But I just couldn't sit, Kate, without talking about your mother. Over 40 years ago, I met her. And she left an impression in my life. She reminded me of my grandmother, my mother. She was so kind to me and always said, Wilfred, and would just love me. Not because I was Victor Hart's senior child, but I was Wilfred Hart. And she treated me like I was one of her own, even though I was seeing her daughter. Y'all hear me? She accepted me as her own. And I fell in love with this thing. I think about her all the time. I think about what she would say to me as that 19-year-old college student thought that he had it going on. She kept me humble. Stay humble. If you didn't know, matter of fact, this is the first time I ever knew her first name. I've always known her by Mrs. McLendon. I see her father, I see the daddy right there. He used to have four different painters going on at one time. And I used to ask him, why do you have so many different paintings going on? And he said, it's all depending on how I feel. I never saw somebody that was so humble and so faithful and so loving before in my life, other than my grandmama, my mama. I had been around, I thought some God-fearing people. But when I met this family, I'm saying, man, she's as close as Jesus you're gonna ever get. God bless you.
Amen, amen, amen. We're going to have about three more folks, amen. God is good. God is good. Amen. Amen.
Hello, everyone. I want to say that out of everything that I've been through, as growing up as a child, sometimes you would need someone to talk to. And I would find myself in conversation with Auntie sometime. And when I tell you that she had a voice that was a song, when she speaks, her voice would be like music. Her voice would be soft. It was a sound that no one else can give you. Her voice was, it gives you a still comfort that no one else can give you. And when you would talk to her, it would resonate with you in your spirit. And she would give you a calm. Not only did she give you that, she give you God. She give you wisdom. And she give you clarity. That is something that was so special to me when I talked to her. And I want to say that even in her old age, she had a sound mind. I mean, she had a sound mind. When I called her, I hadn't talked to her in a while. I seen her at the event we had across the street over here. And out of the blue, I called. And I would think that, being that I never called or reached out to her, I don't think she had my number or calls ID. But I want to say to you all that biblically, she lived a life that resonated and you knew it by this testimony I'm going to give you right now. When I called her, I said one word. I told her what. I said, hello? Her response was, Bernard, is this you? And I looked at the phone. Auntie, yes, it's me. She knew me just by me saying hello. Y'all need to think about that for a minute. Only God could do that at her tender age that she was. That's nothing but a divine revelation that she had a sound mind. She knew your voice. She knew me, and that was something special to me. And that is something that I knew, if she knew my voice, well, my God, family, my God, she was a special woman. And that's what we're here today to honor her. And I thank you all.
Two more. Amen. Come on, brother. Amen. Just come on up and we're going. Amen.
Good afternoon. Bringing greetings from my husband, Reverend Benny Ryan, and my family. We lost our mother on January the 4th. And I can imagine what this family is going through, because we went through it. But I want you to know that I've been knowing this family mostly ever since I moved to Gifford. And I work with Kay and Flossie. They have taught me so much. And Beatrice, she's my classmate, and they are just brothers and sisters to me. And this lady here, I've been knowing her for years, and she was the sweetest woman I have ever known. I remember the time Beatrice and I used to skip school, go to the tomato field. And I don't know whether Miss McLendon know B went, but I know I got a whipping when I got home. But this family just been so good to me. Roy, you know you've been excellent. But we all need to remember, if we want to make it to heaven, we have to know Jesus Christ for ourselves. We have to know him for ourselves. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you will not make it. So it's time for everyone to stop playing church. Stop playing church and get right with God. Because man may not see what you're doing, but God sees it all. So we need to get right, because I know without a shadow of a doubt that this woman is in heaven with the Lord. You all pray my strength in the Lord.
Okay, we're going to have this last speaker.
Thank you, sir. We give honor to our God and to each of you, to the Pastor Jefferson and Sanders and to Bishop Peterson. And God bless you, my friend, my mentor, and to each of you. I am Brother Joseph Pierce, and I can say that I'm glad for the privilege to be able to share just a word, and mainly to be here with this family to walk with you through your valley of loneliness. I know where you are. We have set where you're sitting, and that's not a comfortable seat, but there is a blessed assurance when you know that the person that you are saying farewell to is one who has lived a life, and the reunion awaits you. And that give you peace. That give you peace. My precious little Carla, amen. My niece, I'm so thankful for her and her husband, Brother Roy. God bless you. I told Carla that honey and I was married 11 years before we had a child, and Carla was our first daughter, and so Jane shared it with us, and we just appreciate it so much, and her kids appreciate you. But now, I want to just say that Mother McLendon was certainly a tremendous individual, and we don't have to belabor that point, because all of us know that for certain. And she was a very influential person spiritually, and she exuded joy and peace and warmth and encouragement. She was a Barnabas of sort to her family, to her community, because she was always speaking words of encouragement. And you certainly, when I was, you know, I mean, I was one of the youngsters around, Ella Peterson and all that, and I knew all of her siblings, and we grew up in the same church, Northside Church of God, where I preached I got saved, first of all, at the age of 12, and there, and preached my initial sermon at the age of 13. And I had all of that rich inheritance, that rich influence to help guide me into the way of the Lord and to live a life before me, not to mention my own parents. But I thank God for the Lofton. I knew, Mother Melissa Lofton and Deacon Ray Lofton and all that, and all of their children. It was just so marvelous, even down to the baby, Elizabeth Peterson. Hallelujah. Amen. And I just thank God for them. And you are blessed. You're a family that is extremely blessed to have had a mother, to have had a grandmother, and to have had a friend to help lead you and guide you in that way and provide that kind of a legacy, that kind of a pattern for you. When I was preaching in revivals and stuff like that as a young man out of Northside Church of God, you know, she would slip money into my hand and say, "You need to let this buy you some gas or buy you a sandwich or something." And she supported ministry. She supported evangelism, and I just thank God for that. And in closing, I would say how blessed you are as a family that when we were growing up in Georgia, I was too young to ply, but my older brothers, my daddy taught them to ply a mule. And as he taught them to ply the mule, he said, "I need to teach you how to ply a straight rope. You need to know how to plow a straight row." He said, "Your first row is important. That first row is going to be, your row that you got to go by. That'd be your pattern row. And so he said, the way you plan to ply a straight row, you stand back here at the end. Then you look all the way down to the end of the field, and you point out and you pick out a tree or a fence post. And when you pick out that tree, the fence post, he said, you ply straight toward that post. He said, you just look down every now and then, but keep your eye on that post. And you ply straight toward that post. And when you do that, when you get to the end, you look back and you see you've plied a straight row. And that's called the pattern row. And then after you ply a straight row, then all the other rows can be straight because you plied the first row straight. Amen. And I want you to know, precious heart, this lady plied a straight row for you. And all you got to do now is look toward that pattern. Look toward, let it be your focus point, you know, and she'll point you to Jesus every time. And when you do that, you can plow a straight row in your life for the rest of your life.
Amen. Thank God for all the reflections. Amen. God has been a good and wonderful God to all of us. Amen. But we're not going to hold it any more longer. We're getting ready, amen, for the musical maestro coming with the saxophone at this time. My very own minister of music, James Blossom. Amen. Amen. Let the Lord have his way.
Thank you.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! You, but I know what it feels like to lose a mother. Amen. And it's been like a mother to me. It's been like a mother to me. Me and Pastor Roy have been connected for about over 25 years. But Mother McLendon been knowing me all my life because she knew my mother even before I even was thought about. Amen. And then Brother McLendon there, kin folks to my family. They all painted together. But God is a good God. I'm not trying to get emotional here. I've been good all day long. But the God that I serve is able. My God. Mother McLendon lived a life that became a legacy. And if y'all don't want to catch on, don't just stop nobody else who does. If y'all don't want to uplift the legacy that she leave behind, children, grandchildren, nieces and nephews, sisters and brothers, I beg to differ today. The Bible say when we leave here, we goes up to the throne of God and around the altar crying out, how long they still got to suffer? How long they got to continue to go through their crying to the Lord? Mother McLendon met that number today. She's their homecoming queen today. Some of us are freshmen, some of us are sophomores, some of us are juniors, some of us are seniors getting ready to leave here. We don't know what tomorrow is going to hold, but while the day is here, woo, put not off things. Today for tomorrow is promised to no man. Life is like a vapor. 1 minute is here, the next second it's gone. Life ain't what you consist of, the bodies of things that you may own. But rather that your name is written in the Lamb Book of Life. God's an awesome God. At this time, we're going to have a tribute to our mother. At this time, God's an awesome God. And after that, we're going to have but right now, we're going to have a tribute to Mother. Amen.
But my mother started preparing us for this day years back. She told us for her funeral, she wanted all of us to wear, all of her girls to wear white. She wanted all of the boys, the guys, to wear black and wear black ties and white shirts. And I told her, and she said, "And I want every one of my children to get up in front of the church and talk, say something about me." And I said, "Well, Mama, that's not gonna happen, because I'm not going to do it." She still said, year after year, she would still repeat the same, not just year after year, during the year, she would repeat the same thing. So when I said, "Let me go up here and grab the microphone," because when my mom left, a part of my heart left. I never felt so much pain as losing my mom. My mom would have still been living with me had she not gotten weak and couldn't go up and down my stairs. But me and Mom would sit in my house and laugh and laugh, and I would say, "Mom, if you don't stop this foolishness, you can't make it to heaven." And we would still laugh. And one day she, and I know it came from my Aunt Lorene, my mom said, and when we say my mom would make you laugh, she said, "Mom was 9 years old." So. And Aunt Lorene told her about these panties. Talking about, she's talking about, "I got to get me some of those underclothes with butt pants." I said, "Mama, you got to show them." She said, I've been flat back here all these years. I said, "Mama, my ring told you that. I know you." And it came from my ring. I knew it came from my other ring. But it was just things that we could laugh about. And ain't no, sometimes she get me real upset. We watch The Price is Right, Wheel of Fortune, what was Family Feud. Now she done watched all her shows. Time for me to watch my show. She wanna watch Channel 10, what was it, Oral Roberts? And Black and White. So you know how old it was. And one day I said, "Mama," I was staying over there with Ray house with her. Even when she moved from my house, I would stay at Ray's a lot. And I said, "Mama, I'm just not watching Oral Roberts and Black and White no more. If you don't stop watching, I'm going home." So she said, "All right, I will watch. And then she'll go in the room and watch something else, but she'd come back out and we had to watch Channel 10. So we were brought up in the church. And just like the gentleman came up to speak, we love everybody. If you were in our family, we love you. Even if you're no longer in our family, we treat you the same way as if you are in our family. Come up here, Tim. This is my sister. This is our sister. And this is our sister. This is my one of my younger sisters, my dad's daughter. But she was a daughter to my mother, just like we were. My mom didn't treat her any different or her kids any different. They call my mom grandma to this day. We don't treat you even, my ex-husband Thursday, he ain't here, he's somewhere, but she, when she loved, you know, and she used to tell me, call, and cause he got sick a while back and we're gonna help you regardless. And she was telling me every now and then, call and check on Smoke. I said, "I'm not calling and checking on Smoke." I said, "Mama, you be putting false hope on people. I'm just not getting ready to do it." So I called TJ and said, "TJ, check on your daddy." But I love my mom. And this is my oldest brother, Calvin, standing here. And my mom loved to hear my brother sing. But my brother said he couldn't do it. So we're not going to force him to do it, but he is up here, y'all. And I'm going to just tell you, because I know my mama would say it. She always tried to get me a husband. She had some man call me. I couldn't even understand what he was saying. I didn't even know who he was. And come to find out, she saw him at the wash house. Her, you know, she stopped. She had another man, a garbage man. I came home with a big old car. Came down on my bed. "Mama, where's stuff come from? Big old car, big car." She said, "Well, that guy seemed like he's a good guy. So you need to stop trying to find me somebody. Don't find me nobody, Mama." And she doing the same thing. My big brother. So I'm gonna just try to help him out here because mama gone, so y'all know I jump in.
Well, my mom would call me and say, "Calvin, you're my oldest son. What is it do I need to know?" I said, "Mom, what are you talking about?" "Well, you know some of the things I see on television. I said, "Okay, Mom, if you want to know, I'm going to tell you. You could be talking to someone, and you get these emotions, and you get these feelings," and she'll say, "You could feel something over the phone? I ain't never felt nothing like that." And my sister V said, "Calvin, you better stop talking to Mom, because she gonna ask you some things that a person of her age ain't supposed to be knowing." And I would say, "Well, Mom, what are you trying to talk about?" I say, "If you're talking to somebody, you got a feeling, something just happened to you. What happened to you? You got to tell me." I said, "Mom, things happen to your body till you just get this little tingle. Well, what is it?" Because I really, truly never felt anything like that. And my sister B would say, "Calvin, if you keep on that, Mom gonna come straight to me. Don't talk about no sexual feelings with Mom."
You know, I love my mom and I miss my mom. My mom was a nature person. See, she was in tune with nature. That's why she know your voice when she hear you. My mom loved people. My mom loved colors. She loved flowers. She liked grass. She liked trees. She liked a lot of things. My mom was just a wonderful mom. I remember my mom used to feed us, even though we had free lunch, free breakfast at school. She always fixed our breakfast before we went to school because she wanted us to have a good breakfast. We was my mom's life in Christ. My mom talked about it so much, I used to try to stop her. They know in church, "Mama, please, please stop saying that. Somebody might have a child there," Sister Tonya laughed, because she know. "They might have lost their child." She always said, "The Lord has blessed me with all my children, and all my children living, and all my children going to church." That was my mom's heart, amen? Calvin say, "Mama be calling me, saying stuff like, what is it that I need to know?" I said, "Calvin, she asked me that. What is it that I need to know?" I said, "You don't need to know nothing that you don't know. Stop asking them questions. Calvin, stop talking to Mom about sex. Please. Because Mom go deep in her mind." But she loved us so much. You know, the children are so sad because Grandma talked to them. That's why they love us so much. They right there shaking their head. They go to Grandma. "Let's talk to Grandma, see what's going on. Let's see what Grandma got to say." You know what? I thank God for my mom who raised us in the way. I'm saved, and I thank God for it. My grandmother, somebody say, "Ain't never seen a woman as sweet as your mom." My mom was sweet, but my grandmother was, to me, was sweeter. Amen? I have a sweet grandmother. I mean, my grandmother, a lady told me, she said, "I used to work with your grandmother at Florida Baptist Retirement Center." She said, "Your grandmother was the most humblest lady I ever seen in my life." She said, "Those people used to mistreat your grandmother, and she would never say a word. She would just let them do what they had to do." Amen? And Mom was somewhat like Grandma.
And I just want to thank God for my mother, for who she is. My mother loved all of us. There was no child, I don't care what you did, she never loved one more than she did the other. I don't care what you had, she just never loved one more than she did the other. Amen? And I just thank God for my mom. And I thank God for my sisters. I thank God for my brothers. I thank God for salvation. I wanted to read this. I had to give it to Kate. That's some crazy stuff. Mama say a lot of crazy stuff. Mama say a lot of crazy stuff. One night she lived with me. When she get upset, she'll tell us, okay, I'm gonna go to the nursing home. They know it. She get upset, I'm going to the nursing home. Mama, you know you don't wanna go to no nursing home. Ain't nobody gonna fix you no ham hocks at no nursing home. You ain't going out to eat at the nursing home. You gonna eat what they give you at the nursing home. But she would say that, so one night she said, here's the thing, I think she was mad. This is what I want you to do when it's time for me to die. I said, oh Lord, here she go, she mad. Here she go, she finna die, here it is. See, we had fun with my mom. Just like what I'm saying, she up in heaven laughing right now. She laughing at her own self. She is, she laughing about it. Amen. She said, this is what I want you to say or write or have read when I at my funeral. So I'm gonna read this because this is what she told me late one night. She say, write this, and she told me what to write down, so I pulled it up and I found it, because I had lost it. And it says this, I shall pass through this world but once. Any good, therefore, that I can do, or any kindness that I can show to any human being, let me do it now. Let me not defer or neglect it, for I shall not pass this way again.
Amen. I thank God for my mom, and this is like my sister's case, and this is my sister. And that there was a couple times that my mom was willing to give us away for a little while. One time she got a little upset. I would say upset, disappointed. So she found out that her and my father split up. So she found out sort of in the area where a little lady that my dad was seeing was. So my mom decided that if she had the man, she gonna have the children too. So my mom packed us up in the car and took us to Fort Pierce and dropped us off. The problem was, she dropped us off to the wrong house. To figure out what was going on. We was at the wrong house because he was down the street at another house. Like I said, this is my sister. And when I was younger, and she was younger, my dad, I was down here, and most of my family was still up north in Harrisburg. And I decided to go to see my mom in the summer. And my dad decided to go, and I was taking my little daughter, who was fast years ago, at age 21. I was taking her. Dad wanted to go, and she wanted to go, right? So Dad said, we're going to take the trip. I'm the one decided to take the trip. Dad going with me, but I can't tell Dad no. So I got 20 hours to think about what Mom going to say when I get up there. That was one of the worst trips I ever had. Explain. Why would I bring to you? I got enough of the mom.
Mom said, that baby ain't had nothing to do with it.
Just as calm, she said, that baby ain't had nothing to do with her being here. Because that's what she was. And from that, it was like, when she woke up, I was like, Mom. And it was from there on, it was like, my mom was like her second mom. And even though she didn't grow up with us, but it was like a second mom. And so that was the time when she got wanted to be, she was willing to get rid of it. Another time, my mom told us about she told me about a dream. Two dreams, but one dream she told me about. She said, June, she said, I'm dreaming. She said, I went to heaven, and she said, she was telling me how I looked, and she said, I saw my grandfather, my grandma, she said, I saw start all these people, and she said, it was something else. She said, June, and I messed around and woke up. She said, somebody was upset. She was on. I thought about that thing. I said, Mom was really just to leave us. But that's what. And when Flossie called me that day, she said, I heard her in the voice. She said, June, come over now. And I said, when she called me, I said, because Mom, one thing I always want, I said, Mom, I don't want my mom to be in the hospital and pass. I said, God, I don't want my mom to be in hospice and bad. That was just me. I was without praying. God granted me that. I thank God for granting me that. But when Flossie called me and she said, come over. And I said this to myself. I said, Mom done glimpsed it. Again, I said, I don't care what we do, she ain't coming back. Because the first time she saw, she was willing to leave everything. Everything down. She was willing to. Why? Because she had saw what she was trying to get to. And when you really see where you're trying to get to, when you really glimpse that place, what you've been preaching about is hard to back up. See, for me, it's hard for me to back up now because I haven't seen where I'm going. She had told me where I was going, and I believe what she said. Ella Peterson said it was three generations. He was kind of messing that one up because the fourth generation already started. And the fifth generation, Ella Peterson, we already working on it. We are already working on this legacy. I'm not giving up my position. And I'm teaching my children to grab hold to the same legacy that my mom gave us.
Yes, she was my mom. I remember when I was maybe about 4, walking toward her, and she was smiling. She said, yeah, you definitely your dad's daughter. Look at that walk. She said, yeah, you look more like him than anybody. And every time I saw her, that's what she would say. And I was kind of heartbroken. The last time I saw her, they came to Atlanta. I was staying in Atlanta. And I went to the hotel to meet them. And she said, you go see your dad over there in the room next door? And I said, I ain't think about that man. And she said, you look just like him. And I said, yeah. When I come back, she said, what did he do? Did he give you anything? I said, no. She said, he know better than that. And she was the kind of person that would get my dad straight and keep my dad off me. Every time I go to the house, I would drive over to see her. She stayed in the Highlands, I think with Floss, I can't remember. And I went in there one day and I was so sad. She said, why are you so sad? I said, well, my dad, he gave me $30. She said, $30? I can't even buy a hamburger with that. She said, well, you pray, and and I'm gonna go in here. I'll be right back. When she come back, she put something in my hand, and she told me last time I talked to her, she said, well, if I'm not here, you just tell Coop. And that's what we call my sister Kay, Coop. Coop will get him straight. And she was always so sweet to me. I didn't know the difference. She was just like a real mom to me. Always the same, always humble. Me and her laughed one time. I said, you know, I never seen my dad get mad. But one time, I was 35 years old. I'm 50-something now, but I was 35. And I said, wow. And I have more liking, I think, with my dad and my sisters and brothers. Because my sisters on my mom's side, they're real bold. And they be like, you didn't get them straight. You didn't. You always so humble. And I thank God for that and getting a chance to know her. She was always sweet. And she never told me to use the word step. You're stepping up. You're his daughter. You're my daughter. And so from that day to that day, this day, she was my mom and she was my children's grandma. And I'm going to really, really, truly miss her.
Good morning, all. I'm not going to be very long. My mama, everything everyone has said about her, I lived and I experienced. And she was just a wonderful person. And God bless me to spend 2 weeks with her before the week she passed. And I tried to spoil her as much as I could. She said she had problems with her feet because she was diabetic and she had neuropathy. And she loved Neurosporin. I don't know why, but she loved Neurosporin. So she had hurt a foot and she's like, hey, go to the store and get some Neurosporin. I said, okay, Mom, I'll go. And I went and I got it and came back and I said, Mom, I'll put it on for you. She said, you'll do that? I said, of course I'll go. And she said, okay. And then I was helping her with the bath. And I washed her hair, and anything she wanted, I tried to get. I love my mom, because she was such a fantastic person, you know. And my sister Dee came up here, and she wasn't very honest about mom not having a finger. That was honesty. I know that was my mom's favorite job. And just saying that, I know. I was my mom's favorite. And I have two more siblings up here. They're gonna say that's probably not true, but it is, okay? I love you, Mom. I miss you so, so much. And I always say, if I was a fraction of the woman my mom was, I would be good. My mom led us to Christ, and she was always trying to help me with something, even though you didn't need it. Say, why don't you take this money and go down here and buy some groceries? I was like, Mom, I really don't need your money to buy us groceries, I'm good. But she was always that loving, kind person. And I truly, truly, truly love my mom.
I'm not going to take Faith's spot because she was probably mama's favorite for real. But I just remember, I hear all the stuff and it's so good. I just think about the way my mother was. She did accept everybody. I see my friend Mike over there. And she done named him. She said, now that's my white boy, Mike. That's my white son. He's sitting over there, and if we go anywhere, he's around. And she's like, this is my son, Ray, and this is my white boy, Mike. I'm like, Mama, why you? And she just do that. You know, I had Mama for a long time. And the thing I remember about my mom loved to eat, and she liked money. She loved for me to cook for some reason. And she would wait for me to get ready to cook, and she would call everybody. Ray cooking, coming in. I said, Mama, you gonna invite everybody that I'm cooking? while he's sitting back there, he'd come over there and we'd eat. And I always remember Mom, the thing that was so amazing about Mom is that my kids, they love my mother, and they would tease her all the time. And she would tease them, they would tease her. And as Mom got older and it was just me and Mom in the house, and everybody would be scared to go look at Mama. I'm like, go see if Mom's in there. They're like, oh. I'm like, go check on your grandma. Oh, I ain't going in there. They told me, I ain't heard grandma move. I ain't heard grandma. I told me, your grandma fine. So what I learned to do is when Mama, everybody that's coming to my house for breakfast, they know one thing you're going to get. You're going to get some fat back. Some salt pork. And you're going to get some John P. Key early in the morning. And the thing I remember about Mom, I remember a lot of things, but the thing I remember when it was just she and I, and a lot of times I would just wake her up. I said, I know what's going to get Mama up. I go in there and start cooking. I go in there. You couldn't hear it first. And all of a sudden you hear some movement in the back. And boy, that John P. Key get the singing and hollering. And Mama at first didn't want to walk. So I said, Mama, you need to walk or you're going to fall. She finally got the walker, and then you couldn't take it from her. She couldn't go nowhere without the walker. And Mama would, I always remember, Mama would come down the hallway, and I'd be in the kitchen cooking, and the music be playing that gospel, and I'd be already dancing. I'd be like, yeah, this is it. And I just see Mama just creeping down the hallway. She'd be stepping like this. She'd step on in the kitchen, she'll bounce a little more. She'd bounce, and she'd push the walker, and then she'd just turn the walker loose. Me and Mama had church every morning. We praise God every morning. And I tell kids, I say, if you got a mother still living, spend as much time as with her. Because you ain't never going to get that from nobody else. I don't care, your dad is important, but your mother's real important. And I learned that because I missed my grandmother, because I was in college, so I didn't have a lot of time to spend my grandmother. But when I got the opportunity to spend with my mother, somebody told me, they said, you're going to look real funny without your mama. Because your mama always with you. So you're going to learn from this day on, you need to spend as much time as possible with your mother. I have no regrets. I heard B talk about Mama always get mad and tell me she want to go to the nursing home. I'm the one that took her. Right, I'm on it. I said, Mama, you get mad. I'm going to the nursing home. I want to go to the nursing home. I loaded up the car. Then I took her to every nursing home I could find. They told her, they said, we don't want you. She told me, why they don't want me? I said, you ain't got enough money. And that's just the way my mom was. And I had to tell you, I'm going to tell you one more thing. I love to joke my mother. And she would laugh so my mama loved to laugh. So I was like real serious with Mama. I said, Mama. The last joke I think I played with Mama, I said, you know God promised us 70 years. She said, yeah. I said, that's so good. And I said, Mama, she was 92 then. I said, you 92. I said, Mama, you know what? She said, what? I said, I figured why them young men died so fast. She said, why? I said, because you're still in their time. She laughed so hard. I said, Mama. If you want them young men to keep living, you need to go home. She just laughed. She just laughed. And one last thing, her birthday was March the 13th. And she had this little wedding ring on. She never take it off. And the little diamonds were so little, you couldn't even see them for real. My wife and I was over there, and she was showing her wedding ring and all that. And Mama told me, ooh, girl, that bling look good. Bling. She told me, Ray, look at this here. All my bling is gone. Mama, I'm just looking. I said, you see? I said, I can't see nothing. I had to take the ring, take it to the jeweler. I told the jeweler, I said, my mama said she wants some diamonds. I don't see no, I can't see nothing. He looked at it with a magnifier. He said, it's a few ones supposed to be there. He fixed it, and he put all this stuff on it. And I gave it to her on her birthday. My wife and I gave it to her some flowers. Because she always said, Ray, give me my flowers. We gave her birthday cake, we gave her the flowers, and she put her that ring on her, and you know what the first thing she said? I got my bling bling black.
I just want to thank everyone for coming and being with us and supporting us. And my sister Faith, she was always will be my mom's favorite, but for a reason. Faye gave my mom a debit card, unlimited. Whatever she wanted, whenever she wanted to use it, all she did was swipe it. So she was her favorite. I have to tell you, I'm the one she was with, and I'm the one who found my mother. And I always said, oh, I hope. You know, like Ray said, the kids be scared. I was like, oh man, I don't want to go in the room that mama not living in, you know, because she's old, she's 93. But she always said she didn't want to suffer. She didn't want to be a burden, she didn't want to suffer. So she asked for some soup, and Jasmine gave her the soup. But before I tell that story, I'll tell you what she told Jasmine. She says, Jasmine, when I die, don't let them have me in that casket looking stupid. Don't have me looking stupid, Jasmine. So we hope we didn't have her looking stupid. But Jasmine took her to soup, and the last word my mom said, her last word was child. Her last word was child. And she told Dad that she had a dog, and she said, your dog comes by, and he looks at me. She looks at me, and she goes by. And she looks at me, and she goes by again. And that was the only day my mom kept her door open all day. She would usually close it when she go to sleep, but she kept that door open all day. And she said, Dad, I know you don't have any children. This was her last word. She said, but Callie, that dog, that's your child. And she and Jasmine laughed, but I think about that last word was child. And she loved us, she loved her children, her grandchildren, all the time. But when I went in there and I walked by and I said, Mama, you didn't eat your soup. And she didn't say anything. I said, Mama, you didn't eat your soup, because she always playing jokes. I said, Mama, so you sleep, you went to sleep. She didn't say anything. You know, just a calmness came about me. And I looked at her chest, and I said, Mom, Mama, Mama. And I shook her, and when I did, and I touched her face, and it was so calm, and it was warm, and it was, you know, you just know that she was already gone to heaven. I just felt she was already gone. And of course, then flesh kept getting in, and you know, I start calling everybody and panicking. But I already knew, because it was a upset spirit, but yet and still it was a calm spirit. And then I thought the other day about my mom. Her last day, she and I would talk a lot about this day. This day, and she said, well, Flossie, I wanna say something to you. I said, what is it, Mom? She said, you know, of all my children, you're the one that I can't get to. I said, what? She said, you're the one, because she'll have you taking her to the nursing homes. She'll worry you so bad you'll take her. But she said, you're the one that I can't get to. I never did upset you. You're always so calm. And she had told me to keep the family together. You know, still have your Christmas party. And then when she died, I thought, you got to me. This is what you say. Okay, I can't get to you. I got to you. But I know my mom is in heaven. She was preparing us for that day. She had told us, don't buy her any more clothes. No more clothes. She wouldn't take my father when I was over. They were best friends. And every time he would go over to my mom, he would give her, you know, he'd visit unless he had a $100 bill. And Dad went in the room, and Dad came out, and he said, Well, Bell would take my money. Dad said, I'm kind of scared to go home. Because he knew something wasn't right. Ray went to the grocery store. We never take money from Mom, never. And Ray called me and said, I dropped everything off, but Mama insisted I didn't take the money. I didn't want to take it, but she insisted, so I took it. And she started saying, you know that thing, that suit you bought me, that jacket, you can wear it. The tag's still on, I'm not gonna wear it. You know, that robe you got me for Christmas, I'm not gonna wear it. Give it to Jada, I'm not gonna wear it. So she already knew that she was going to be with the Lord, but my mother was a wonderful, wonderful mother. And she would always call us. I was listening to some voice messages, and she was saying, Flossie, you know what? And I have this on voice message. She says, don't worry about anything. She said, what we gonna do? We gonna pray about it. Let us pray about it. And she said, don't you worry about anything. You hear me? Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. So I'm saying to the family, don't worry about anything. Just pray about it.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, saints. Amen. And there's been a few minor changes to the program, but at this time we will have our selection from Mother Renee Frazier. At this time, amen. As she comes forth, let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Amen. Mother Frazier, let God be God. Amen.
Giving honor to God and to each of you, I thank the Lord, and I know what I just said. I thank the Lord for being here, and I appreciate the family asking me to do this. And when Ella Ray talked with me, he said, Mama liked them old songs. And I said, I know, so I had something in my mind, but when I got here, when you know it, Elder Tim Peterson decided to do a whole medley of stuff that I had in mind. And so I said, well, I guess I'll just go this route. And I thank God for this family because they've always been kind to me. All of my life, I'll say yes, Lord. For all of my life, I've been truly blessed, Lord, because you gave me my salvation. Oh, yes, you did. Yes. Yes. To my Lord, all of my life, I'll say, yes, Lord. For all of my life, I've been truly blessed, Lord. One day you gave me my salvation. Oh, yes, you did. Oh!
live a same life and to just praise him because you gave me, God, I thank you, Jesus, my salvation. Oh, yes, you did.
Amen. We thank God. Amen. Now this time, how many ready for the word? I said, how many ready for the word? Amen. At this time.
Would you please stand just for a moment, please? Just for a moment. We're not going to return you. We're not going to try to raise the dead. And we definitely don't want to go behind this family. Somebody say amen. Well, let's have a word of prayer. Would you bow your heads with us? Father, once again, we want to thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We want to thank you, God, for the love that you have shown towards us. I want to thank you, God, for the angel that you placed in this family. How that she had begun a good mother, and also the things that she had taught them, they have received it, and most of all, for the life that she had lived. Now, Father, we ask you for a word. Speak to our heart that we may speak to these people. In the precious name of Jesus Christ. And let us all say amen. God bless you, may be seated. We do give honor to the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. And also to the pastor of this great church, my friend, Reverend Jefferson. Amen. And also to our presiding, amen, Brother Sam Jenkins. And to our pulpit guest, amen, my Chefferland friend, Reverend. We won't call his name, but we just thank God for him. I'm just pointing him over when he's eager over there. That's him there. But most of all, we like to say to the musician, we appreciate you. The choir you sung so beautifully, and also we want to thank God again for the attribute that was, amen, said and related to the deceased on today. Somebody say amen. I want you to know you make preaching real easy. So what I'll do, I'll just come back behind you with a few words, and we'll be getting out of here. Somebody say amen. I want to thank God again, amen, for Pierce being here with that straight rope. So we're going to go straight down that road so we won't make a mistake. Amen. But we want to say again, it's an honor just to be here. We'd like to say this, amen. I didn't ask to do this funeral. Amen. I was selected to do this funeral. This was requested by her that I'll be the one. Somebody say amen. And I'm pretty sure in her life and the people that she met, she have had preachers that I can touch a pole with. But because she insisted that I be the one, and when I heard it, amen, and heard she had passed away, I knew it was my time then. Somebody say amen. But I want to let you know, I'm not long-winded. I'm not trying to be here to try to change anything. But I just want to thank God for this opportunity. And I want to say to the family, you have a great, great, great mother. Yes. Amen. Amen. A beautiful mother. Yes. Yes. Listen, we're just going to take you to the book of St. Matthew, chapter 25. And we're just going to read a couple of verses from this chapter. And from there, we'll proceed from there. Amen. I'd like to say again to the musicians, amen, and especially my friend, Brother Orville, y'all did an awesome job. Yeah, won't you give them a hand just for what they're doing? And Timmy Peterson, I just don't know, he just mess up things when he get into the group. So, amen, I want you to know these some of the offspring related to the same woman that we, amen, offer tribute to him today. From the book of St. Matthew, Gospel, chapter 25, amen. We're going into verse, amen, number 14, and we're just going to read about three or four verses. If you give me 10 minutes, I'll be out of here. Somebody say amen. Here we find these words, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and deliver unto them his goods." Amen. And here in verse number 13, we find these words. "And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. To every man according to his several
this journey. Somebody say amen. Amen. Let's move down just a little further. Verse number 19. After a long time, somebody say a long time, the Lord of those servants come and reckon with them. Somebody say amen. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou delivered unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained besides them 5 talents more. Somebody say amen. Let's go down to verse number 21. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant, because thou hast been faithful over a few things. Somebody said a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy, amen, somebody said, of the Lord, of thy Lord, amen. Amen. I just want to talk a little bit, amen, from verse number 21, when it says, thy good and faithful servant. Thy good and faithful servant. As we observe the life of this great woman of God today, amen, and many lives that she came in contact with, she left, amen, memories of good things. I want you to know she ain't always been good. But the good that she had that God had granted her, she had an impact on the lives that she came in contact with. Amen. I want you to say this before we move into this any further. Never think you are good. Ain't nobody good but God. Nobody good but God. The good that you receive, God has allowed you to experience that while you're here. Somebody say amen. Not only that, but when it then manifests and displayed upon others, you go far and wide. No matter what you say, your name be known from one place to another because of the good God allowed you to express to others. God wants you to be what he is to you so you can be to others and show them what's in you. Somebody say amen. Goodness don't come from the outside. It comes from the inside. And I want you to know this woman had a mark of God. And that was goodness. Come on, somebody. Not only that, but as we look at the concept in which God allowed her to live here, amen, the life she came in contact, and as I listen at the testimonies being given on today, I can truly say she was a woman of God. Amen. She didn't dot every I, she didn't cross every T, but what she reflected from her, amen, only came from God, because God is a good God. Can I get a witness on that? God is a good God. And because of this goodness God had placed in her and she had expressed it to others, amen, she can be used an example to follow after. Let's go back to the scripture here, for example. The Bible said there was a man. He had servants that worked it for him and labored for him. And he decided to take him a trip. And when they were getting ready to take the trip, amen, he called them together and began to give them talents. And the concept related to talents, if you follow it, it means money. Somebody say amen. But one thing about the word of God, if you listen to God real good, he could give you a revelation concerning the same thing that'll bring confusion to your mindset. Somebody say amen. And therefore, as he gave them talents, amen, the first one, amen, he gave 5 talents. And told them to occupy till you get back. Amen. The next one, he gave 2 talents. And finally, he gave one. But the instruction that he gave to all of them was the same thing. Use what you got, amen, and make what I want you to make out of it. Somebody say amen. Listen, this mother here had a talent. Amen. And that was goodness in her life. She had a talent. Amen. That was love in her life. And she would use it for the glory of God. Come on, somebody. Everybody wasn't pleased with what she did, but I want you to know when it was all over with, what you could say about her was only one thing. She was a good woman. Somebody say amen. Let me say this today. Ain't nobody perfect here. Come on, somebody. But the God that we serve is perfect. And therefore, to him be the glory and the dominion and the power forever. Can I get a witness on that? But listen to me. Listen real good. Amen. And the talent that God had placed in her was goodness. Amen. Now he became back after a long time to the same men that he had given talents to. And wonder what they had did with them while he was gone. The first one that had the five talents, he ran and met the Lord and said, Lord, you gave me five. And I multiplied them. Now I got 10. I gave me five more to what you gave me. Somebody say amen. What are you doing with yours? Are you gaining anything? Somebody say amen. Well, we'll get down to the one that you might be commended to, and we'll talk about him too. But next, the one that had two talents. Amen. He came back and told him, said, Lord, you gave me two, and I got two more. And I gained, amen. Now I got twice what you gave me. Somebody say amen. Let's listen to what the comment came from the owner of the one that was in charge, that had and distributed to them the things that he wanted them to use while he was gone. Amen. The first one he told him, he said, well done, that good and faithful servant. Somebody say amen. It's good to be good. Because good comes from God. He said, but good and faithful. Somebody say faithful. Not faith now, but faithful. And when you look at the word faithful, it does not imply faith. Amen. It defines the ability that you have, that God had placed in you. Being faithful, amen, give us the indication related to the action of God that we ourselves, amen, can show forth to the world what God is all about. Somebody say amen. The word faithful is defined as being dependable and trustworthy. Come on, somebody. Can you count on God? Can you depend on God? Can you trust God? Come on, put your hand together and tell him, thank you. He's dependable and trustworthy. And therefore, he said, well done, that good and faithful servant. And I want to say this, amen, to Mother of the Day. Amen. Why you picked me, I don't know. But I want to say this to her. Amen. Maybe she can't hear me. Maybe she can. But I want her to know, in my eyesight, she's a good and faithful servant. Come on, somebody. Good and faithful. Always trying to show someone the goodness of God in the life that she lived. Somebody say amen. Not only that, but she was trustworthy. Amen. Whatever she tells you she'll do, she'll do all she can to perform that. That's trustworthiness. Somebody say amen. And therefore, finally, amen, the one that had given the talents after them to be productive in what they had, he said unto them, amen, enter thee into the joy of thy Lord. She's leaving here. And I want you to know she ain't going anywhere. Come on, somebody. There's a place God got for her. And we call it the joy of the Lord. Somebody say the joy of the Lord. Amen. There's no better place to be than be in the presence of God. But the Bible declared to be absent from the body. Somebody say absent. In school, they used to call a roll. Whatever they do, call a roll. If you were there and your name was called, you said present. Somebody say amen. And finally, when they called my name, amen, many times I wasn't there because I was trying to make a living for nine more. Somebody say amen. So therefore, when the Sabbath was called, there will be a delay in response. Somebody say amen. Amen. But I want you to know today, she's not here. Somebody say amen. She's absent from that. But she's present
She is with the Lord. So if her name is called on you, you can call her here all day long and you won't get a response. But if her name is called up there, it will be present. Present. Because the life God has given her has been fulfilled, and all the talents, all that God placed in her care has been multiplied, and therefore she's absent from the body, but she's present with the
Hallelujah.